Hope you all can hear me now. You all can hear me.
Any one of you can hear me?
Yeah, okay. Firstly, we'll start with local anesthesia. Just not a theoretical part at all. Just the, I'll just run through a few questions and then I'll let you know what are the important things. Then, as you all asked, we'll do dental emergencies, management of medical emergencies in dental office and medically compromised patients. Okay. Later we will talk about few MCQs which are most commonly asked, the pattern of it and all that we will talk. Okay. As you all know, local anesthesia is one of the very commonly asked questions. There are at least 3 to 4 questions every year in any of the exams. Most of the times it is asked. So we'll just briefly run through this. This question was asked once. Local anesthesia has been defined as a loss of sensation in the circumscribed area of the body by causing the depression of excitation only in the nerve endings or an inhibition in the conduction process in the peripheral nerve. There is no sedation that can happen with, this was asked, there is no sedation. A local anesthetics cannot cause any kind of, sedation. It's just the depression of the excitation in the nerve endings without causing sedation. General anesthetic drugs will cause sedation, but local anesthetic drugs cannot cause any kind of sedation. All right. Ideal properties and skipping. Electrophysiology. This question was asked once. As you all know, at the resting membrane potential, the membrane. The resting membrane potential of a nerve membrane is -70 millivolts. This was asked once or twice. It was asked. Normally, it is more negative inside. Within the nerve membrane, it is more negative. Whereas outside the nerve membrane, it is more positive. This was asked as an assertion and reasoning or true or false question. See, in the resting membrane potential, there is the charge of the nerve membrane inside is more negative when compared to the outside. All right. Then the firing potential or the slow depolarization is around -50 to -60 millivolts. Whereas when it comes to a rapid depolarization, as you can see, the charge is reversed in the nerve membrane. Outside it is more in the threshold potential, or when it is reaching a rapid depolarization, outside of the nerve membrane is more negative when compared to the inside. So they can confuse you here. Normally in the resting potential, resting nerve membrane, it is more negative inside. Whereas once it has started acting or in the rapid depolarization phase, it is more negative outside and more positive inside. All right. Again, the repolarization of this is usually -60 to -90 millivolts. This was not asked. Most of the time, this question was asked. The resting nerve membrane potential is around -770 millivolts. Okay. As you all know, theories of LA, acetylcholine. The question asked here can be, what are the theories? One of the following is not the theories of local anesthesia, or which of the most commonly used or favored theory are the questions which can be asked. The first and most obsolete, most of the times we don't use, is acetylcholine theory, calcium displacement theory, surface charge or repulsion, membrane expansion theory. This is again very important. Membrane expansion theory supports the benzocaine. As you can see, one of the local anesthetics, benzocaine, will act according. The mechanism of action of benzocaine is based on the membrane expansion theory. As you can see, the local anesthetic molecule will go and it expands the, it gets attached within the membrane and it gets swollen up or it gets expanded, closing the voltage gated, sodium gated channels here. So benzocaine is the mechanism of action of benzocaine is based on the membrane expansion theory. The most commonly or most favored theory is the specific receptor theory, whereas binding of LA is specific or usually it gets attached to the specific receptor on the sodium channel, resulting in decrease in the rate of depolarization. Remember this, DD, decrease in the rate of repolarization, followed by failure to achieve threshold potential, finally conduction blockade. Remember this thing, D and D, decrease in the depolarization rate. All right. This is the complete mechanism of action. It gets attached, binding of LA to the receptor site, blockade of sodium channel, decrease in sodium conduction, depression in the electrical or decrease in the electrical depolarization, and then failure to achieve the threshold potential, lack of development of propagated action potential, and then finally causing a conduction blockade. Right. This is again one of the most commonly asked question here. Local anesthetics produce a loss of function in the following order. First is the pain. Very, very important. Pain is the first sensation which is lost. Once you inject a local anesthesia, it is the pain which gets lost first, followed by temperature, touch, and then last is the skeletal muscle tone. The return of sensation is again in the reverse order. First, the skeletal muscle tone gets reversed, then touch, then temperature, then pain. So, the last thing the patient, after the reversal, the patient will experience pain at the last. But the loss of function, first the pain will be. You can take a screenshot of this. Local anesthetics, these produce a loss of function in this order. Pain, temperature, touch, and skeletal muscle tone. Okay. This is again another question asked here. Local anesthetics, as you all know, they are ester type and amide type. They differ in their intermediate chain. Okay. See, aromatic portion is same. Lipophilic portion is same in the ester group and also in the amide group. Okay. Even here, you can see the amine portion is also same. But they differ only in the intermediate chain. In the intermediate chain, esters will have an ester group, whereas amides will have an amide group. This is the difference. So this was also asked. Usually local anesthetics differ in their intermediate chain, not the lipophilic and hydrophilic. Hydrophilic end and lipophilic ends are the same in both ester and amides. As you all know, the classification, ester group and amide group. Ester group, benzoic acid esters, para-amino benzoic acid esters here. Non-ester groups like amides. Remember one thing, I think I have already told you before, amides will have two I's in it. If you get confused anyway in your exams or anything, remember one thing, all these amides will have two I's in it. Amides will have two I's in the spelling. So as you can remember in that way. Okay. Here you can see in the ester group, it is only one I and everywhere it is one I, whereas in the amide group, it is two. You can see etidocaine, lidocaine, mepivacaine, prilocaine, etc. All these will have two I's in that. Quinolone group is senbucridin. Okay. Yeah. The clinical implication here is esters are metabolized to a common. They say esters are very commonly, they might cause allergic reactions. That is because of the metabolite PABA. Common metabolite PABA, which might cause allergic reactions. Allergic reactions rarely occur with amide linkage, okay? And the metabolism, as you all know, esters are rapidly metabolized in the plasma by cholinesterases, whereas amides are slowly, you can see the difference here again, esters are rapidly metabolized, whereas amides are slowly destroyed by liver microsomal enzyme. If the patient is allergic to local anesthesia, most of the times they will not be allergic to local anesthesia. It is the compounds in that, usually a methyl paraben, the preservative which is used, or the ester group, sometimes the patient might be allergic. So if the patient is allergic to both esters and amides, a 1% of diphenhydramine plus 1:1 lakh epinephrine is given. You can take a screenshot of this again. It was asked once, I believe. Allergic to both esters and amides, you can use this 1% diphenhydramine. Based on the duration, you should again, many times it is asked, short duration is lidocaine, bupivacaine and prilocaine, whereas intermediate is, you should remember one thing here, lidocaine is, they have given it in both the things, short duration and intermediate duration. Here, 4% lidocaine is intermediate duration, whereas short duration is 2% lignocaine without adrenaline. Okay. So if it is with adrenaline, it is intermediate. Okay. Articaine, lidocaine, mepivacaine, prilocaine, all this intermediate. Longer acting is bupivacaine. Bupivacaine is the longest acting. It is more than 90 minutes. All right. This is again based on the biological mode of action, not really asked, not very important. They are based on the biological side. For example, class A, just to remember, just to know, agents acting at the receptor site on the external surface of the nerve membrane or the biotoxin. Class B, they will act on the internal surface. Class C is receptor independent physiochemical mechanism, benzocaine. Okay. And then agents acting by combination of receptor and receptor independent mechanism, all the other. Class D, all your local anesthetics come into class D. Composition, again, as you all know, local anesthetic agent, vasoconstrictor, other agents like antioxidant, preservative, fungicide, salt, vehicle, etc. Okay, this is it. Local anesthetic will cause blockade, sodium chloride, isotonicity, sterile water, volume of the solution, vasoconstrictor. This is again asked many times. As you all know, it increases the depth and duration of anesthesia, delays the rate of absorption, decreases bleeding, and reduces systemic toxicity. The question here can be asked as, one of the following is not the action of a vasoconstrictor. Okay, they'll give you all these options. They'll give one odd option which you have to select. So it has got five things. Depth and duration of anesthesia, delays the rate of absorption, decreases bleeding, reduces systemic toxicity. Sodium metabisulfate is an antioxidant which is used. Methyl paraben is the preservative. Why are we using an antioxidant here? Adrenaline will get usually, or the vasoconstrictor which we are using will usually get oxidized with the atmospheric oxygen. So to prevent that, we add a sodium metabisulfate. This was asked once in one of the exams. Why is an antioxidant added? It is because epinephrine or adrenaline is highly unstable and it gets oxidized with the atmospheric oxygen. So in order to prevent that, we are adding a sodium metabisulfate or an antioxidant. Methyl paraben is the preservative, and then thymol is a fungicide. Okay. The next question, or dissociation constant, pKa. All right. Dissociation constant is something, the amount of free base which is available for the, that means the RN group, the local anesthetic, which is available for the action is called as a dissociation constant. Okay. Lipophilic group will get attracted to the phospholipid layer of the nerve membrane. So whenever there is an acidic environment, there is a decreased pH. Okay. So the more H plus, the equation will shift towards the more of cation, less free base, all that base which is there now, because pus will have all H plus ions. And the base or the local anesthetics will get attached to the pus ions or the H plus ions which are present. So the LA is not very active in acidic environments or whenever there is an acute infection. So this question was asked. Remember, the local anesthetics are very less effective in acidic environments or in cases of abscesses. So in such cases, infiltration is very less effective. In such cases, or in any space infection cases, or in any dentoalveolar cases, always give a block, always give a nerve block rather than going for an infiltration. Infiltration will be less effective. As you can see in this picture, if there is an, for example, somewhere here, there is an abscess or something. So if you give here, all the local anesthesia will act with the pus here, not with the nerve membrane. So that is why you will give a local anesthetic nerve block in cases of, you know, in cases of any infection. Okay. So, and one more thing here, usually aspiration before injection is very important, because rapid injection, this was again asked, what will rapid injection of local anesthetic does? It gives a high toxicity due to increased levels at the same time. So especially in cardiac patients, we have to give, or in any patient to the cardiac patients, we have to give a, as you can see here, intravenous, if you give IV, or if you're without aspirating, if you're giving into the blood vessel, or if you're giving it very far into the, very faster into the nerve, then the toxicity increases. And especially if you're giving into the blood vessel, the maximum level will reach within one minute itself. Okay, if you're giving it topical, 5 minutes, intramuscular, it will take around 5 to 10 minutes. Okay, so give a rapid, give a very slow injection. Rapid injections are contraindicated.
Close for me.
Remember one more thing here. Sorry, somebody's, this thing is, I can hear somebody's voice. Any doubt? Yeah. The other important question here is, they can cross the blood-brain barrier and they can cross placenta also. So when you're giving it to any patients with the pregnant patients, or in the patients with some kind of blood pressure or any medically compromised patients, you will have to be very careful. All right. Okay, as we have discussed before, esters will get hydrolyzed very rapidly in the plasma by the enzyme pseudocholinesterases. Rate of metabolism, see, that is why esters have a higher complications or higher allergic reactions, because they are rapidly metabolized. They get metabolized very rapidly. All right. Excretion, most of the times it is excreted to the renal, by a renal way or a kidney. Okay. So in such patients, again, if the patient has a problem of, if he gives a problem of any renal problem or hepatic problem, you will have to be very careful while you are giving, because the excretion is done by kidneys. So if there's any kidney issue, you will have to carefully evaluate that patient. All right. This is, again, be knowing it, the maximum dosage of local anesthesia with adrenaline is 7.7 mg per kg body weight. Plain adrenaline without any adrenaline, you will give it 4.4 mg per kg body weight. And in cardiac patients, it is 0.2 mg per kg body weight, the adrenaline level. Okay. Contraindications for local anesthetic. Only contraindication for local anesthesia, absolute contraindication, is if the patient is, as you can see in the picture here, you can take a screenshot of this, local anesthetic allergy, documented bisulfite allergy, then you will have to, it is an absolute contraindication. All right. The other contraindications are atypical plasma cholinesterases, methemoglobinemia, significant liver diseases. Why significant liver dysfunction? Because all your amides will get metabolized in the liver, microsomal enzymes. So in liver, renal, and cardiovascular systems, you will have to be, it's a relative contraindication. You will have to use it judiciously. Do not over inject or give a very slow injection, and try not to repeat the blocks and local anesthetic infiltrations and all that. You will have to be very careful or use it very judiciously. All right. Then clinical hyperthyroidism. This is, again, is not an absolute contraindication. Most of you will think hyperthyroidism is a absolute contraindication. No, it is a relative contraindication. Clinical hyperthyroidism, ASA 3 and 4. Hope you all know what is ASA. ASA classes. Okay. If you don't know, you just note it down. I'll give you what it is exactly in the next, and then the dental emergencies and medically compromised patients. Okay. So in these patients, you will have to high concentrations of vasoconstrictors, as in gingival retraction cords. Okay. Here they'll have a racemic epinephrine in gingival retraction cord. So in such you all can hear me? Hope you can hear me now again. There was an issue with the network actually for a while. Yeah, okay. Yeah, gingival retraction cords are completely contraindicated in clinical hyperthyroidism patients. Alternatively, if you are not using a lignocaine with adrenaline, you can use mepivacaine 3% or pilocaine 4%. All right. This is again, I think I have explained you last time also. This is just again, I'll just give you a brief thing here. Calculation of lignocaine doses. This was asked many times. What do you mean by 1% lignocaine, 2% lignocaine, 4%? To that matter, anything. Okay. So just multiply that A percentage. If they are asking you 3% lignocaine, that means 30 mg per ml of lignocaine is available. Okay. If it is 4%, if it is 10%, 10 into 10. If it is 3%, 3 into 10. So, A percentage, for example, X percentage is X into 10 mg per ml. All right. So, in 1 ml, that means in 1 ml, you have 20 mg lignocaine. Okay. So, for 1 kg, how much you can give? 7 mg. So, for a 70 kg adult, you can give around 490 mg of, or approximately 500 mg of lignocaine. That is mg. Now you should convert this mg into ml, right? So in 1 ml, how much is there? 20 mg lignocaine is there. So you have your, the syringe is of 2 ml. All right. So in 2 ml, you have around 40 mg of lignocaine. So on the maximum, if the patient is around 70 kg, you can give around 25 ml of lignocaine with adrenaline. That will come up to 12 syringes, 10 to 12 syringes of lignocaine you can give to the patient before he actually develops the, before the threshold is achieved. Okay, around 10 syringes you can give. Hope you all got this. Otherwise, I will explain it again. All right. See, remember one thing, 1% is 1 into 10. 2% is 2 into 10. Remember this, you can take a screenshot of it. A percentage is A into 10 mg. This question was asked many times, which are the commonly used topical anesthetics. The most common the effectiveness of the topical anesthesia is only up to 2 to 3 mm depth. Okay, it is around 2 to 3 mm. Remember one thing here, the effectiveness is up to 2 to 3 mm and absorption is rapid. So, in cardiac patients or in patients with hyperthyroidism,
pardon, ma'am.
Okay, whereas in the topical sprays, it is higher. The concentration of can't hear me.
Yes, ma'am, your voice is breaking. Now is it fine now? Yeah, ma'am.
Okay. I'll repeat. Topical anesthetics are effective only up to a depth of 2 to 3 mm. Be careful when you don't puff it up onto the patient's this thing. Okay, just one or two puffs should be enough.
The voice is not clear.
Is it fine now?
Can you speak more?
Yeah, okay. See, EMLA or a eutectic mixture of local anesthetic is, it produces a surface anesthesia of intact skin. Remember this. This can be used on an intact skin also. Whereas the lignocaine gel and all that what we use, they are not effective on skin. They are just effective on mucosa. This question was asked in a recent exam. Okay. It produces surface anesthesia of intact skin. It is composed of equal mixture of lidocaine and prilocaine, 2%, 2.5% each, which is an emulsion in which the oil.
Can you tell from the previous slide?
Sorry?
Can you tell from the previous slide, please?
Right. Yeah. I was telling about the topical anesthetics, okay, which are usually effective on the surface up to a depth of only 2 to 3 mm. That is the reason while we are giving injection, we first spray, because the initial prick of the injection will not pain. That's it. It cannot penetrate more than 2 to 3 mm. And
Here you don't have, in the topical anesthetics, you don't have a vasoconstrictor. So the absorption is rapid and it fades off very faster. Okay. I was talking about the eutectic mixture of local anesthetic, MLA. Okay. This is important because it can be used on the skin. All other local anesthetics, what we regularly use, topical anesthetics, cannot be effective on skin. The spray what we use in our departments, it is not effective on skin. Okay. It is composed of equal mixture, that is 2.5% lidocaine and 2.5% prilocaine. All right. They are used in a oil phase. This was asked in a recent exam only. This is used for procedures like venipuncture and needle insertions. Okay, it produces surface and is numbness 1 hour after the application. Okay, and reaches a maximum of 2 to 3 hours and lasts for 1 to 2 hours after the removal. Okay, here this kind of UTEC MLA is used for skin procedures like your pricks, your ear piercings and all that. Usually nowadays everybody is using this MLA, mixture of lidocaine and prilocaine. Okay, this is supplied in 5 grams or 30 grams tube or an anesthetic disc. This is very important. You can take a picture of this. All these points were taken from a question paper itself. These were the options for the questions asked. Lidocaine, again, as you all know, it is available as 5% and 2% gels. Okay, there are patches, lidocaine patches also, right, which can be applied onto the mucosa. The recent advances was asked once, there is something called as a wand injection. These are all painless techniques for local anesthesia. It's a wand injection and also iontophoresis nasal spray for maxillary dental arches. This question was asked, what is wand? It's a kind of jet injection wherein it is a kind of, needleless injection. You just give a kind of a jet injection, just insert that, you have a kind of a nozzle there, just where you'll have to inject it, just put it there and give a flush. That's it. It acts as like a normal normal injection itself, but since it doesn't have a needle, it doesn't pain. Right? That's it. Any doubts in this? Or shall we... Yeah, there are a few questions actually. Calculations you were asking, right? Most of you have asked about the calculations. Firstly, remember two things. One is, if somebody is asking you, what do you mean by 2% lignocaine or 3% lignocaine? Just do one thing. Add, if they have asked you 2% lignocaine, just do 2 into 10. If they are asking you 3% lignocaine, do it 3 into 10. So that means in 1 ml of 1 ml local anesthesia, you have 10 mg or 20 mg, whatever it is. 20 mg, 30 mg. In 1 ml, you will have so much percentage. For example, if it is a 2%. Yeah. If it is a 2% lignocaine, you have 20 mg per ml. That is, in 1 ml, you have 20 mg of local anesthesia. Okay. But our syringe is 2 ml, right? You have a 2 ml syringes. What will you? So in 2 ml syringe, you have around 40 mg of lignocaine. Only I'm talking about lignocaine first, then I'll tell you about the local the adrenaline also. Okay, so 1 ml will contain 20 mg. We have talked about the maximum dosage, right? You have 7 mg/kg body weight is the maximum amount of local anesthesia with adrenaline what you can give to the patient. That means 1 kg, if the patient is 1 kg, you can give only 7 mg of local anesthesia. Okay, if the patient is 70 mg, how much you will give? 7 into 70, that is around 490 mg. It is in grams, milligrams, but we can't give it in milligrams, right? We are giving it in ml, we are injecting it in ml, so we'll have to convert this into ml. So what we have learned, 1 ml will contain how much? 20 mg. So 500 mg is there in how much? It is there in so much, 500 into by 20, it is 25 ml. So maximum for a 70 kg body weight adult, you can give around 25 ml of local anesthesia, lignocaine with adrenaline. Okay, that will come up to how many? One syringe will is around 2 ml, right? So if 25 ml is there, you can fill it up in 12 or 10 to 12 syringes you can give without actually causing any problem to the patient. All right, this is about the calculation of lignocaine, how much lignocaine you can give. Now somebody was asking about adrenaline. See, in adrenaline, the maximum amount of adrenaline you can give in a cardiac patient is 0.2 mg only per kg body weight. If somebody is asking you how much adrenaline you will have to give in a cardiac patient around 70 kg, just multiply into 70, 70 into 0.2, that's it. All right, somebody was asking about the topical anesthetics, the last slide. Okay, you can take a picture of this. This is as it is, it was asked in your exams. Okay. So anything else? Yeah, somebody was asking me 2%. Yes, okay. 2% LA contains how much adrenaline? See, again here, adrenaline is, you should calculate it in two types. Okay, if it is 1:80,000 adrenaline, depending on how much, 1:80,000 or 1:22 lakh or 1:1 lakh, you will have to calculate the amount of adrenaline. Okay, so in that concentration, usually they will ask you how much is the concentration of it, 1:80,000. If it is, for example, if it is 1:80,000, that means 1 ml of lignocaine will contain around 1 by 80,000. That is around 0.05 or 0.04 mg. 1 by 1:80,000, you will have to calculate. Okay, depending on the concentration of adrenaline which we are using. Normally, you have in your departments, we will have 1:80,000 adrenaline. All right. Okay, any other question? The adrenaline. Yeah. Okay, anyways. Now, you know, calculation of adrenaline is based on the concentration of adrenaline present in each of that vial. See, on the vial itself, it will be given 1:80,000 adrenaline, or if it is 1:1 lakh adrenaline, it will be given. So that means 1:80,000 is 1 ml contains around 1 by 80,000. Percent of adrenaline, that will come around 0.25 or 0.05 something. Just calculate it, 1 by 80,000. Okay, accordingly, 1 ml will have so much. So in 2 ml, it will be double. That's it. Got it? somebody has told no, again I'll tell you. Or I'll what I'll do is in the break, I'll just write it and send a picture to it. Okay? Send how I have done a calculation on that. I'll send a picture. All right? Right. Shall we start another topic? I'll send you a picture of both how to do a calculation for local anesthesia and also for the adrenaline. Right? Yeah. Okay. Okay, I'll quickly finish off with BLS in 10 minutes. Okay, basic life support. These are again many questions were asked in this. BLS is defined as the preservation of life by initial establishment or maintenance of airway, breathing, circulation, and emergency care. See, basically, remember one thing here. BLS generally doesn't include the use of drugs or any invasive skills. Basic life support is just what we are doing with your hands and mouth. That's it. If you are using some sort of medication or if you are using some sort of any other, higher or advanced thing, then it will go into an ACLS, Advanced Cardiac Life Support, or if it is because of any trauma or any fracture, then it is called as an Advanced Trauma Life Support. But if you are not using any drugs, just with your hand if you are doing, that is called as a VLS. Okay, it's a pre-hospital medical care. Okay, it should be done anywhere immediately. It should be done by, can be performed by anyone, anywhere immediately without any equipment. Okay, this is the first thing you remember. Okay, this is called as a chain of survival, which was asked once. Okay, first thing, if you see a patient in an emergency unresponsive, what is the first thing you do? You call for a help. Always remember, most of the times it is asked in your exams, what is the first thing you will do? Okay, first is recognize and call for help. In the options, if it is given as call for help, answer will be called. What is the first thing if you do if the patient is unconscious? Call for help. Then you start your CPR or whatever it is. Okay. You can take a picture of this. This was asked, chain of survival. Okay. It is early recognition and call for help. So this is to prevent cardiac arrest. Early CPR to buy time. Early defibrillation to restart the heart if at all the patient is already in the cardiac arrest. And then post-resuscitation care to restore the quality of life. Okay. See, there is something called as a biological, just please note down this, there is something called as a biological death and a physiological death. Okay. So, what does that mean? Even if the body is completely down or if it is physiologically dead, the body still has little amount of blood which can be pumped, and this can be usually, it can save a patient's life also. So that time before the heart has stopped functioning and the patient is completely dead, you have around 6 to 8 minutes time. Okay, this is called as a 6 to 8 minutes. You still have a time for the patient. You can make the patient alive again. So that is around 6 to 8 minutes. They write down that. Okay, even after the patient is cardiac arrest, you have 8 minutes time to save the patient. That 8 minutes time is where you can do your BLS. All right. If the person is, you can see this picture, the person collapses. Check if the patient is unresponsive. Okay. See, just see here, the patient is breathing or patient is not breathing. Okay. Just check for the A, B, C, airway, breathing, circulation. Okay. Just check for the, how will you check for the airway? Just look, listen and feel. That is what you do. You inspect the chest. Remove all the, the clothing which is tight and all that. Just inspect the the chest. If it is raising and falling down, that is look. Listen. Listen if the air, that sound, breathing sound you can hear or not, you just see that. Then feel. If you're not able to listen it properly because of the disturbances, just feel. Just put your finger near the nostrils to see if the patient is breathing or not by just the air which is coming out and going out through the nose. Okay, just check if the person has circulation or if the person has no circulation. If there's no circulation, start with the basic life support, that is start with the cardiac compressions, which I'll be showing in the next slides. Okay, this is asked. Shout for help, check for response, shout for help, open the airway, that is if the patient has any kind of clots or anything, just open the airway. Check for breathing, call for help, and start giving 30 chest compressions and 2 rescue breaths. Okay. Steps in the adult basic life support. D, R, A, B, C, D. Okay. First is danger. See how danger, or see if you are under any danger, if it is something, you have to look out the surroundings also, if there's any, is it because of the bomb blast or if it is because of anything or if it is just the cardiac arrest which has happened. Then response, check for the responsiveness of the patient, airway, breathing, circulation and defibrillation with AEDs. Okay, assess for danger and remove the person and yourself to a safe environment. Do not attempt to move someone by yourself. Wait until the help arrives. Check for the responsiveness. Check for ABC, blood pressure and pulse. Okay. If unresponsive, shout for help. Okay. Dial an emergency. And then assess for breathing and circulation. Okay. As I told you, look, listen and feel is the most commonly you do for breathing. Then circulation, monitor and check pulse. Where will you check the pulse? This is again asked. It can be checked in the radial, that is near your hand, radial pulse. If that is not there, you can check for your carotid pulse near the neck. Okay. Check for, this is asked once or twice, I believe. You can check for the carotid pulse near the neck. Okay. How to open an airway? You will try to lift the, tilt the head backwards, chin lift and slightly jaw thrust. Get your lower jaw forward so that if there's, the airway will be open up. Manual clearing of mouth and throat. If you have suction or anything, do a pharyngeal suctioning. Okay, see, as you can see in the picture, this is a head tilt. You've tilted the head and you're trying to lift the chin like this. Okay, so that you are trying thereby lifting the tongue from back of the throat. Place the hand on person's forehead and gently tilt the head backwards like this. Okay, this was asked once or twice. What are the manuals which can open the airway? Head tilt, jaw thrust and chin lift. Okay, this is how the jaw thrust is done. just put your fingers near the this way near the angle of the mandible. Okay, the jaw is displaced forward, pulling the tongue away from the back of the throat. Position yourself behind the head of a person. Place the fingers behind the bony part of the jaw, as you can see here, and thrust the jaw upwards away from the chest. You can do or do all the clearing. If there are any visible solids or loose fitting dentures, all that you will have to do. Okay, yeah, this is again very important question. Hemilich manual, if there is any problem or foreign body obstruction within the airway, you will do something called as a Hemilich manual. Okay, lean the person forward slightly and stand behind him or her, like as you can see. See, you should make a fist like this with one hand. Put your arms around the person and grasp the person like this and give a quick hard movements inwards and upwards. Okay, very important Hemilich manual. It is asked many times. You can take a picture of this. If it is a kid or an infant, place the infant stomach down, as you can see here, across the forearm, and give 5 thumbs on the infant's back with the heel of your hand. All right, place the if nobody is there, only you are there, and there is a choking thing here, then place the fist above the navel while grasping the fist with the other hand. You can see here this way, and leaning over a chair or countertop, drive your fist towards yourself with an upward thrust. Okay, this can be done on your own if nobody is there. If there's a help, you should do this kind of Hemilich manual. This is for infants. This Hemilich manual is done for foreign body obstruction in the larynx near the airway. Okay, and the most common, this was again asked, one of the most universal signs of choking or a foreign body is that the patient will have choking and patient will try to hold the neck. Okay, it is called as a universal choking or universal choking sign is that the patient will try to hold his neck with 2 arms. Okay, signs: choking, discomfort. If it is a mild obstruction, discomfort in the throat, whereas severe obstruction, the patient will not be able to speak. The other signs is that if it is a mild obstruction, patient can speak, breathe, cough. But with a severe obstruction, he might go into an unconsciousness, or he will try to cough. Cough is again, it's a kind of a protective mechanism. Okay, assess the severity. If the patient has got some kind of obstruction, if it is an unconscious patient, start with I'm sorry, there was an internet issue. So we were talking about breathing. Hope you all can hear me, or is it fine? If anyone can answer, I'll So breathing, how will you check for breathing? It is
Is it hear me?